University Hospital to include a very big center for clinical nephrology dialysis, and we hope that this center will be in reality soon. We selected for Dr. Mostafa. Usually Dr. Mostafa shared with us his perspectives about infection control and vaccination, and he has a lot of publication in this field. But in this course, I discussed with him to change our mind. So his topic today is intradialytic hypotension, which is the most common complication of hemodialysis. Dr. Mostafa.
Same. Actually, I am your student, same here. Welcome, Egypt. As I said, actually, I am a student for Dr. Hussein, who is my prof, and he was there with us. Talking today about intradialytic hypotension, we are understanding, despite an over increasing understanding of its complex pathophysiological mechanism, along with the technological advances in dialysis delivery, still intradialytic hypotension one of the most frequent complications. Experienced by individuals on hemodialysis. Intradialytic hypotension is defined as a decrease in systolic blood pressure more than 20 millimeter mercury, or a decrease in main arterial blood pressure by 10 millimeter mercury, associated with symptoms and the need for nursing and intervention. Classification, we can classify intradialytic hypotension into acute hypotension, sudden drop of sudden of systolic blood pressure below 90 millimeter mercury, or at least 20 millimeter mercury with clinical symptoms. For recurrent intradialytic hypotension, at least 50% of dialysis sessions. And we have chronic hypotensive patient where intradialytic systolic blood pressure is maintained at least 90 or 100 millimeter. 70% of patients on hemodialysis at least experience one episode. Of all patients on hemodialysis at least experience one episode of hypotensive attacks, and it represents about 20 to 20% of complication during hemodialysis. Patients at risk for intradialytic hypertension include those 65 years old, diabetes, patient with cardiovascular disease. Poor nutritional status, including hypoalbuminemia and hyperphosphatemia. Patient with uremic neuropathy or autonomic dysfunction due to other causes. Patient with severe anemia the patient requiring high volume ultrafiltration more than expected intradialytic ventilation. Patient with pre-dialysis systolic blood pressure less than 100 mm mercury. And the pathophysiology of intradialytic hypertension would depend on the rate of ultrafiltration with impaired response to fluid removal due to cardiac problem, autonomic response, and vascular response. The dry weight, the optimum dry weight has double faces. If we reach to the dry weight, we expect that the frequency of intradialytic hypertension is increased due to decrease the interstitial fluid space. As we in here in this diagram count the fluid shift from intracellular fluid to the extracellular fluid, and from the extracellular fluid the fluid passes through the bladder and the ratio we move, and this is the process of ultrafiltration. If we have a decrease in the intracellular fluid compartment or optimum blood pressure or optimum dry weight, we found that the rate of movement of fluid from intracellular fluid to extracellular fluid is increasing. So the patient will experience a type of hypertension. Our response to hypertension improves the hormone. We have a bar receptor activity and chemo receptor activity and ROS system. Activation of both bar receptor activity and chemo receptor activity through stimulation of sympathetic nervous system. And by then, it will need to increase the peripheral resistance, increase the heart rate, and increase the cardiac contractility, which will need to increase the blood pressure. Failure of any of these steps will lead to hypotension. Impaired baroreceptor sensitivity is not common among human dialysis patients, but may be present. And the patient may have impaired cardiac response, such as left ventricular hypertrophy, left ventricular dysfunction, or reduced myocardial reserve, and subclinical myocardial ischemia. The mechanism which can affect the filling from interstitial space to the vascular space may include the following: increase in the hydrostatic capillary blood pressure, or decrease in the oncotic pressure due to hypoalbuminemia, or depletion of interstitial fluid volume due to low sodium concentration, high transcellular urea gradient, dry podiumic error, and high ultrafiltration. The true phenomena, when hypertensive attack takes place, our body makes a mechanism which includes splenting and cutaneous circulation vasoconstriction. Failure of splenting and cutaneous vasoconstriction may occur in hemodialysis patient due to acetylation, release of cytokine, autonomic neuropathy, and cerebral stress. This leads to splenic pooling of fluid and vital failure of shifting of fluid from interstitial space to extracellular space. Intradialytic hypertension may take place due to factor related to the patient and factor related to the procedures and the heterogeneous factor. And by then, it will lead to organ hypoperfusion, either cerebral, cardiac, or mesenteric vascular. Neurological dysfunction, structural abnormality which may include brain atrophy, which is common among hemodialysis patients, but we found that patient with recurrent attacks of hypotension has the ability to have brain atrophy more than others. Myocardial stunning, which is a phenomenon, transient contractile dysfunction that persists after reperfusion despite the absence of irreversible damage, and despite the situation of normal or near-normal coronary blood flow. This phenomenon is common among hemodialysis patients which have attacks of hypotension, and the repeated myocardial stunning at the end will lead to reduced left ventricular function, chronic heart failure, and higher rate of cardiovascular event and increase in mortality.
Patient with intradialytic hypotension are more likely to thrombosis to the AV fistula. And as we see here in this study published in 2011, they divide patients into four quarters according to the degree of hypotension, and we found that patients with increasing, marked decrease in blood pressure has a rate of more vascular thrombosis. The mortality rate among the hemodialysis patients with intradialytic hypotension increase if the systolic blood pressure is sent in hemodialysis more than 40 millimeter mercury or the diastolic blood pressure more than 10 millimeter mercury. How to manage a case of intradialytic hypotension? We have many types of management, but we have patient, but you have patient in front of you with attacks of acute hypotension. We have acute management, and we have preventive measurement to prevent the attacks. During the attack, you should reduce the rate or stop the ultrafiltration. Put your patient in trained liver position, reduce the blood flow, and give to your patient 250 milliliter of isoprosmolar saline or albumin or even mannitol, and exclude serious condition like ischemic heart disease. You should learn your patient that he shouldn't increase more than 3 kilograms in the intradialytic period, in the intradialytic weight gain, by salt restriction and increasing frequency of hemodialysis 2 to 3 hours, 4 to 6 days a week, if your patient has a frequent attack of hypotension. Longer duration of hemodialysis, intradialytic administration of hypertonic saline during the early part of hemodialysis. If your patient has a frequent attack of hypotension, give to your patient early in hemodialysis before even he has attack, triple saline, 25% glucose, mannitol 20% and albumin. We should increase sodium dialysate, isolated ultrafiltration, sequential dialysis and ultrafiltration, and automatic biofeedback control hemodialysis system. The measurement of dry body weight, as we said, dry body weight has a double face. If we reach to the optimum, our patient will experience more attacks of hypertension. So we should detect the dry body weight accurate by using the bioimpedance analysis. We can use inferior Funakeva index and inferior Funakeva collapsibility index. Measurement of bilirubin and reticulocyte, blood volume monitoring. Optimizing of cardiac function include abdominal binder, intradialytic nootropes and vasopressors, intradialytic echocardiography. Improving the vascular tone, high dialysate calcium, using midodrine and the cooling of the dialysate. Here the difference between bicarbonate dialysate and acetate dialysate, we found that the frequency of intradialytic hypotension in hemodialysis patients using acetate dialysate is about 56%. When we use bicarbonate dialysate, the percent only 2%. We can summarize that as we see, first line approach, sodium restriction, refining from food, prevent food during the dialysis, clinical assessment of dry body weight, use bicarbonate as dialysis buffer, use dialysate temperature of 36.5 degrees centigrade, check dosing and the timing of anti-hypertensive agent. Second line approach, try other methods for assessing dry body weight, perform cardiac evaluation, gradual reduction of dialysate temperature up to 35 degrees centigrade, consider individualization in blood volume control feedback, prolong the dialysis time, prescribe dialysate calcium concentration of about 1.5 millimole per liter. Third line approach, consider adding midodrine, consider adding L-carnitine, and if your patient we failed to start dialysis, hemodialysis, we should prescribe him peritoneal dialysis. This is our guidelines. Also, sodium profiling with supraphysiological diuretic sodium concentration and the high sodium diuretic more than 144 millimole per liter are effective in reducing intradialytic hypertension. They shouldn't be used routinely because enhanced risk of cyst hypertension and increased intradialytic bleeding. The use of diuretic calcium concentration 1.5 millimole per liter should be considered in patients with frequent episodes of intradialytic hypertension unless contraindication is present. In patients with frequent episodes of intradialytic hypertension, low magnesium dialysate should be avoided, especially in combination with low calcium dialysate. Hemodiafiltration techniques shouldn't be considered a first line option for the prevention of intradialytic hypertension, but possible alternative to cold dialysis, we should call the dialysis session early. Sequential isolated ultrafiltration followed by isovolemic dialysis shouldn't be used as a regular strategy for prevention of intradialytic hypertension. Prolongation of dialysis time or an increase in dialysis frequency should be considered in patients with frequent episodes of intradialytic hypertension. At the end, hypertension, we can summarize intradialytic hypertension in this diagram. Ultrafiltration, the response of our body is increased sympathetic nervous system activity and increased renin angiotensin aldosterone activity. By tear, vasoconstriction and vein constriction, if the ultrafiltration rate exceeds the ability of our body to compensate, intradialytic hypertension will take place. If the ultrafiltration doesn't exceed the ability to compensate normal blood pressure, we can help our patient and prevent hypertensive attack by using midodrine, cool the dialysate, increase the dialysate calcium, L-carnitine, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mostafa, for your presentation. And now it is open for your questions.
Thank you very much for a nice presentation. I have two questions. First, I'm asking the lower limit blood pressure to start dialysis. Repeat it again, please. Lower limit for blood pressure. When can I send patient for dialysis? Or when would be what should be contraindicated for any dialysis?
Yes. It means that do we have blood pressure?